Hello everyone, we're getting ready to look up today with a brand new Uplook video with an enriching top 10 list. You can like the video, subscribe, and ring the bell to make sure you don't miss out on any of our future videos. Today's topic, 10 reasons it's vital that we study Bible prophecy. Scholars calculate that 1/4 to 1/3 of the Bible was prophecy when it was written. Prophecies are different from predictions. They must be sufficiently detailed, sufficiently remote, and sufficiently unambiguous that ordinary coincidence cannot explain the foretold event. It's true that only God can prophesy. The fascinating study of Bible prophecy is like traveling on God's time machine. And here is our first good reason. Now, who talks about Bible prophecy today?
Well, of course, everybody in the Bible did. And we ought to get a hold of this because it opens up to us God's scheme for history.
So our first one of a reason why we need to study Bible prophecy is because it proves that only the Lord is God.
Isaiah 46, 9 and 10, the Lord is speaking through Isaiah and he says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there's none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure." Now we have the linchpin of Bible prophecy is the book of Daniel. And the book begins with a scene at the office. The king comes in and he has all of these rent-a-prophets around and he says, "Fellas, I had a dream the other night, can't remember what it was. I want you to tell me the dream and tell me what it means." And they said, "Now, king, that's not how you play the game. You tell us the dream, we'll tell you what it means." He said, "Well, now that's the easy part. I want you to tell me the dream first and then tell me what it means. And as a little incentive program, if you don't, I'll chop you in pieces." Well, they couldn't do it. And they had to confess, only the gods can prophesy. Well, Daniel comes in and says, "King, don't panic. Don't lose your cool here. Give me an evening with God. If God wants to tell me, he can." He comes out the next day and says, "Here's your dream and here's what it means." And so before Daniel prophesies the future, he prophesies the past, and he gives something that the king can authenticate. Yes, this really is the case. So that's what we have in the Bible. God says, "I'll tell you the future." So when it happens, you not only knew the future beforehand, it's not to satisfy your curiosity, it's to give you confidence in what I say. So that's the first good reason. Only the Lord is God. He knows the end from the beginning. And we can count on what he says.
Then number two, because it grows our confidence in the word.
Revelation 22, verses 6 and 7, he said to me, "These words are faithful," that is, they are trustworthy and true. "And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show his servants the things which must shortly take place. Behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book." So here we have this idea that God here is called the Lord God of the holy prophets. So God had through time, at different places in different countries, men who were moved by the Holy Spirit to speak on behalf of God. And they were telling people what they needed to do. So prophecy always has a moral dimension to it. In the light of these things, how should we live, right? So the fact that I know there's going to be a sudden appearance of Christ, John says, be careful how you live so you won't be ashamed before him at his coming. I know I'm going to be at the Bema, at the judgment seat of Christ, and so I want to invest my life well so I won't suffer loss when I appear there. And all of these events that are still future, there are present implications given in the Word of God. So the Word of God doesn't simply give me prehistory, it gives me things to bring me into alignment with God's purposes. So he not only says that it's good for us to know that these words are faithful and true, trustworthy and true, but he says there's a blessing in keeping the words of the prophecy of this book. So the prophecy doesn't simply tell me of future events, it tells me how my present behavior will influence that, right? So he that has this hope in him purifies himself. I should be able to tell if your eschatology is right, if your understanding of future things is right, by the way you behave in the present.
Number three, because it shows a plan and purpose in history.
Some people say, for example, why does Joseph have to rub it in to his brothers in telling them that he had this dream where he was like the sun and the moon and the stars were all bowing down to him? Or like he was the sheaf and they were all bowing to him. Wasn't he just rubbing it in? Well, no. It had to be shown that when Joseph did end up on the throne in Egypt and his brothers did bow to him, it was not an accident of history. In the same way that Jesus drove the Jewish rulers crazy when he said to them, the next time you see me, you'll see me coming with my holy angels in the glory of my Father, right? The next time they see him, it won't be like this was an accident of history. This was a plan that God had, and he was working it all out, right? So there are chapters that we see in the Bible where God actually lays out to the Jewish people by chapter, chapter by chapter, what he's going to do. So to Abraham in Genesis 15, he explains what's going to happen from the time of the patriarchs all the way through until the conquest of the land of Canaan, how they'll end up going down into Egypt. They'll end up being slaves there, and then in the fourth generation, they'll be delivered and be allowed to come back, right? Then to Moses in Leviticus 26, he goes from the conquest all the way through to the Babylonian exile, and he talks about the collapse of the kingdom and so on. Then to Daniel in chapters 2 and chapter 7, he goes on to explain everything that's going to happen from the time of the Babylonian captivity in which Daniel lives, all the way through until Messiah comes. And then the Lord Jesus, as he sits with the disciples on the Mount of Olives, he takes up the message from there and goes right through to the end of time in Matthew chapter 24. So from these four chapters, we can read, before it happens, the whole history of the Jewish nation. Remarkable, remarkable.
Then number four, because it provides apologetic proofs for evangelism.
There's no other holy book that can boast this. If I showed up at an airport somewhere and the people who came to pick me up had never seen me, but they immediately picked me out of the crowd, well, they show me the secret. Someone sent them a family photo with me in it. And they were just looking at the details of the photo and matching the people who came off. So there's a 6'6" basketball player and a little old lady with purple hair. And eventually somebody comes by who is a reasonable facsimile of the picture, and they walk up and say, "You're Jabe Nicholson." So God, instead of using a photograph, had sort of a paint-by-number, paint-by-prophet portrait of Christ, where different artists painted in little bits and pieces until eventually the portrait was complete. But what's interesting about the portrait is all the bits and pieces appear to contradict each other. So you'd never logically say this. One prophet says he's going to be coming out of Egypt. Another one says he's going to be called a Nazarene. Another one says he's going to be born in Bethlehem. What? And the answer is yes, yes, and yes. They all came true. And they all came true because of the enemies of God. It was Caesar who forced them to be born in Bethlehem. It was Herod who forced them to go down to Egypt, and another Herod that forced them to live in Nazareth. So God actually used the enemies to fulfill the prophecies. And this is a masterpiece. It wasn't his friends that fulfilled these scriptures saying, "We'll make him look like the Messiah." Who paid the 30 pieces of silver? Who gambled over his coat? Who drove in the spear, right? It was his enemies who did this. And all of these prophetic details that were given throughout history, hundreds of years before it happened, appear to contradict each other. And yet, when they come true, you have an apologetic argument to say, if Jesus fulfilled 300 prophetic details the first time he came, and he said, I'm coming again, I'd take him real seriously. He has a really good track record of keeping his promises. So there's a good argument. Now, what's interesting is that the writers of the New Testament very often used the Psalms as apologetic arguments. We don't normally think of doing that. But for example, when Peter argues the case for not only the death of Christ, which can be proved from many passages, but his resurrection, he goes back to the Psalms. Thou wilt not leave my soul in the grave or suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. So all through the scripture, we have prophetic scriptures, not just in certain key places. And the more we read it, the more we discover what an ironclad case God has given us for the proclamation of the gospel. We can take this to the bank. We can be sure of this.
And then along with that, we have number 5, because it authenticates the claims of the Messiah.
Right. The Lord said to the Jews of his day in John 5:39, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but these are they which testify of me. So the idea that if you look for Christ in the scriptures, you'll see God's plan. People who spend all their time in the book of Revelation trying to understand what the third toe of the second beast means, they're going to be nothing but confused. But look for Jesus in the book of Revelation. It is called, strange as it may seem, the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we have him as the Ancient of Days in chapter 1. We have him as the Lord of the churches in 2 and 3. We have him as the judge of all. We have him as the heavenly bridegroom, the Lamb of God, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. There are all these portraits of Jesus. We have them as the man-child. All these portraits of him all through the book of the Revelation, when the Lord Jesus saw those discouraged disciples on the Emmaus Road, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So as we learn to see Christ in the scriptures, now a David Baron, who was a converted rabbinical scholar, he wrote a book, for example, like Type Psalms and Prophecies, and he says that the rabbinical scholars saw many more passages speaking of the Messiah in the Old Testament than evangelical Christians would ever dare to assume. They saw him even in more places. Now, they didn't think it was Jesus, but the scriptures are redolent with the aroma of Christ. Everywhere we look, we can smell the perfume of the Lord Jesus. And it's a tremendous encouragement for us to lay hold of this truth that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy.
And number 6, because it spurs us to devoted service while there's time.
When Peter writes to the Christians in the first century, he says in 2 Peter 3, verse 11 and then 14 and then 17, he has a series of B statements and he says, therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, be holy. What kind of people should you be? Be holy. And then he said, therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent. And then he says, therefore, beloved, since you know these things beforehand, beware. All right. So be holy. Be different from the world around you. Be diligent. There's no time to waste. And then beware. It's a dangerous world we live in. So we're in the know. God hasn't left us in the dark. You're not asleep. You know, you're wide awake to what's going on. So sometimes we're fooled into watching Fox News and thinking that's what's happening in the world. We need to be reading this book. There's no fake news in here. And God will tell us exactly where we are in the divine schedule. Now, can we set a date? No, because all of these things are gradients. Men shall wax worse and worse. There'll be an increase of knowledge, increase of travel. At any point on that gradient, I can say it's worse than it's been before. More earthquakes, more wars, more rumors of wars, but I can't say categorically, definitively, this is it. The point is we need to be ready. We don't know exactly when the Lord's coming back, but we should be ready. And so the prophetic scriptures inspire us and encourage us, motivate us to get with the program while there's time.
Number 7, because it confirms God's special relationship with Israel.
Israel is God's alarm clock, his timepiece. And as it goes with Israel, so it goes with the nations. He set Israel in the midst of the nations. And God has always let Israel know what's going on. So as we see things happening with the nation of Israel, we should realize that things are ramping up. We talked about this earlier, that when the children of Israel were brought back to fix up the city of Jerusalem, rebuild the walls and so on, this was setting the stage for the first coming of Messiah. Well, Israel is now back in the land. And the fact is that they need to be there in order for the Lord to come back again. Now, we're not saying that these are the fulfillment of particular prophecies. I think people fall into the trap of thinking the blossoming of the fig tree in Matthew 13 is the 1948, the restoration of Israel's political history, but it isn't. The blossoming of the fig tree is the restoration of their religious history. The generation that sees the restoration of temple worship and priesthood and sacrifices, that will be the generation that will see the Lord come back in power and glory. Nonetheless, there are indicators in the world, and when we see these things, we should look up because our redemption is drawing near.
Number 8, because it encourages us to purify our lives.
I referenced this verse already. Now we are children of God. It has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. That's 1 John 3, verses 2 and 3. So John is saying here, we know the end game. We know what God's intention is. What is it? It's that we be less and less like the old Adam and more like the new Adam, less and less like the man of dust and more like the man from heaven. That's God's plan. That's what he's doing. So if that's the case, let's cooperate with his plan and let's lay aside the things that are unchristlike, that are worldly, and let's lay hold of the things that are Christ-like. So since we know this plan, in other words, I'm a part of prophecy. God has prophesied concerning me. God has prophesied concerning you. And he's told us what you're going to be 2,000 years from now, or considerably less. So I ought to get on the wagon. I ought to understand, where is he going with this? Okay, then let me cooperate with him, because it's going to happen. Might as well happen with my cooperation as opposed to me kicking and screaming, right? So it should encourage us to take that program seriously.
Yeah, not the Jonah method.
Exactly, not the Jonah method or the Jabe method.
Right.
Yeah, do the God method, yeah.
And then number 9, because it stirs up love and loyalty for our heavenly bridegroom.
We've just heard it said that when he's revealed, we'll be like him. And also in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 28, now little children, abide in him that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. I've told the story before, but it's so graphic in its illustration. There's a difference between loving the Lord and loving his appearing. Every Christian loves the Lord. You can't help it. We love him because he first loved us. But loving his appearing is a different thing. So when I was a boy, we didn't drink a lot of soda pop, but every once in a while we'd have some folks over and we'd buy a few bottles. Well, in those days, the big bottles were 5 cents deposit and the little ones were 2 cents. And so if you took them back to the store, you got that refund. So my father, being a Christian, although a Scotsman, decided that he would let me keep the change for the pop bottles if I took them back to the store. So after we would have some folks, family in or whatever, and we had a bunch of bottles, I'd put them in my little wagon and I'd take them up to the store. Well, on this particular visit, I just had a handful of bottles. But the lady who was looking after things, she took those few bottles and put them into a cart full of bottles. And as she went to ring up the amount, she was called away by the manager. So she motioned to another clerk to come over and look after me. The clerk came over and, not knowing the before part of the story, counted all the bottles in the cart and went to ring up a rather large amount. And I remained silent. And I began to rationalize and think, well, it's not my mistake. And the store can certainly afford it. I'm not sure if I thought of it, but maybe I could even give a little of it to the Lord's service, you know. But anyway, I was ready to take that money. And just as I reached out my hand to receive this wad of bills that she was paying, out of the corner of my eye, I caught something familiar, and I looked over, and it was my father walking towards me. Now, I loved my father, but I didn't love his appearing. And so that's really the question. Am I living in such a way? Are there attitudes, ways of behavior, situations with fellow believers, activities, things I'm watching? If at that moment the Lord came back, would I love his appearing? I think we all will love it when we see him. But John says, be careful that when you're living now, at any moment, it's going to be the moment just before he comes. So make sure that you're busy with his business, occupying my mind, my life, my eyes, my behavior are in line with that moment when he comes, so I won't be ashamed before him at his coming.
Then lastly, number 10, because it ministers comfort in difficult times.
A lot of God's people are going through hard times. Not only the things that we go through here, but around the world, many of God's people are barely hanging on, going through deep times of suffering, and governments are mounting up persecution in countries like China and India. It's becoming extremely difficult for them. The closing words of 1 Thessalonians 4 are, therefore comfort one another with these words. So the idea that the Lord knows, the Lord has allowed history to unfold as it does, this is not the last chapter. The Lord is writing out the story, and the last chapter finishes with these words, and they lived happily ever after. So shall we ever be with the Lord. And so it's not a fairy tale. It's really going to happen. Anybody can do anything for one day. And so if today I say, well, today could be the day, I live in the good of that, in the present hope of his coming. If not, his mercies will be new tomorrow morning to get through the next day. And day by day, I anticipate, I wait for that moment. When Leonard Sheldrake died, Bill Pell and Bill McDonald were standing at the casket. And one of them said, you know, he never expected to die. He was counting on the rapture. He said, you know, he never expected to die. And the other one said, no, but what a wonderful way to live. God help us to be those kinds of people who are heavenly minded, who are anticipating the Lord's return, who don't allow hope deferred to make the heart sick, to say, well, I know why he's waited another day. It's because he doesn't want anyone to perish. God help us to comfort one another with these words.